Penguin Random House Audio presents Robert Ludlum's The Bourne Defiance by Brian Freeman, read for you by Scott Brick. Skinvilly, South Ossetia Region, the past. The five-day war between Russia and Georgia had taken place years earlier, but the Treadstone agent known as Kane still saw the after-effects of the conflict around him. He passed abandoned farmhouses with their roofs caved in by mortar fire. Tall grass grew around bombed-out rubble, and the stone walls of a lonely Orthodox church bore the pockmarks of bullets. The area felt emptied of people. Many of the refugees of the region had fled south to Tbilisi and never come home again, leaving ruins of their old lives behind them. Kane knew he was on the right path. He could follow the trail of blood and footprints. His target was wounded, probably dying. Initially, there had only been a few tiny red drops in the white snow, but the evidence of blood came more frequently now. The stains larger. Abel was slowing down, losing strength. He couldn't be far away. The pursuit had taken Kane north out of the town of Gori. Abel's left rear tire had blown near Tergvisi, and since then he'd proceeded on foot through the rural countryside, making a run for Russian-occupied territory. Kane had gotten close enough to him in one of the empty farm fields to land a bullet in the man's back, but then Abel had struggled to his feet and disappeared into the trees again. Kane and Abel. Holly Schultz, who had assigned the code names, had a malevolent sense of humor. She'd teamed them on Treadstone missions for years. They'd saved each other's lives often enough that they were almost like brothers. Kane had thought he knew the man well. He'd trusted him. But under the jokes, under the disguises, under the Beatles songs he whistled before a kill, Abel had been an agent with a deadly secret. Abel was a traitor, a Russian asset. And now, Kane had been sent to kill him. He stopped in the forest, listening to the hiss of November wind and feeling the wet flakes of snow on his eyelashes and inside his heavy boots. The snow made the whole world quiet, and in the silence, he heard movement, branches snapping close by. It wasn't Abel. The blood trail didn't lead in the direction of the noise. He was more concerned that it was a Russian soldier. He wasn't sure which side of the border he was on, and the Russian base at Eredchi was just a few miles away. Kane leveled his Makarov, a Russian pistol he'd acquired upon arrival in Georgia. The assassination needed to be done with a foreign gun. Holly had been clear about that. There could be no evidence of American involvement. He snapped his shoulders from side to side, his eyes hunting for movement in the trees. Then he saw a tiny face and lowered his weapon. It was a boy, no more than 9 or 10 years old. The boy came out of the trees, not looking scared. He had a dirty face, greasy brown hair that was raggedly cut, and intense blue eyes. He wore a pullover shirt that resembled a burlap sack, plus torn jeans and red rubber boots that were caked with mud. The boy took note of the gun in Kane's hand. "You hunt that man?" the boy asked in Georgian. Kane nodded. "He is Russian?" Close enough, Kane thought. So he nodded again. The boy pointed through the trees. "I saw him go in a farmhouse over there. He's bleeding. But he has a gun too, like you. Be careful. You kill him, okay? Shoot him dead. Kill the fucking Russians." Kane dug some coins from his pocket and handed them to the boy. Then he nodded his head for him to run in the opposite direction. The boy thumped his chest twice with his fist in a gesture of solidarity, then vanished silently through the snow. The farmhouse was close, not even 100 yards away. The wooden front door was open, hanging from one hinge. It was a small structure, mostly destroyed by bombs, and he circled the place to confirm that there were no other doors, just the one way in and out. Kane smelled the smoke of a fire and the stink of boiled cabbage. As he neared the door, he heard singing from inside. Back in the USSR. Abel wasn't hiding his location. He knew Kane was out there. Between the lyrics, his voice broke in alternate fits of laughing and coughing. Then he called out, his words slurring as he got weaker. "Come on in, Kane. We might as well get this over with." Kane led with the Makarov. He moved fast, expecting a battle, but there was no gunfire as he spun through the door. Instead, he saw Abel sitting in the corner of the main room, lost in the shadows on the wooden floor. He wasn't alone. His legs were spread wide, and he had one arm around the waist of a black-haired teenage girl sitting in front of him. With his other hand, he held his pistol to the terrified girl's head. "Hey, Kane, this is Tatiana. Say hello, Tatiana." When the girl said nothing, Abel shoved the gun hard into her dark hair and repeated in guttural Russian, "Say hello."
"Hello," she gasped.
Tatiana was undernourished, her arms and legs skinny. Her plain face was winter pale, and tears leaked from her dark eyes. Her whole body trembled. She couldn't have been more than 15. "Let her go, Abel," Kane murmured, aiming the Makarov at the man who'd once been his friend. But he didn't have a clean shot, not without risking the teenager's life. Hurting her won't change how this ends.
"Oh, I think you're wrong. See, I know you too well, Kane. You're always a hero when it comes to women. It's your fatal flaw.
Let her go," he repeated. Abel managed to laugh. He leaned forward and kissed the back of the girl's head, keeping his face barely visible. It was clear that Abel had a wary appreciation for the accuracy of Kane's shooting, even with a foreign gun.
"So, here we are," Abel said. "You and me, brothers in arms.
Here we are." Kane studied the man's features in the shadows. Abel was a master of disguise and rarely looked the same way twice. He could be young, old, blonde, red-headed, dark-haired, and have blue eyes, brown eyes, or green eyes. About the only thing that gave him away was his walk when he thought no one was looking. A strange way of gliding so that his shoulders seemed to float above his hips. But here, at the end, he was simply himself. Tall, strong, blonde, blue-eyed, smart, and arrogant when he smiled.
"Yes," Kane thought, seeing the truth for the first time. "He's Russian."
Abel had been a Russian mole from the beginning, a graduate of Putin's charm school, designed to blend in like a native and infiltrate the U.S. intelligence services. He'd played them all, fooled them all, Kane included. Tatiana struggled in Abel's grasp, but the man held her tight. Staring back, he seemed to read Kane's mind.
"You think they want me dead because I'm a traitor, don't you?"
Kane didn't answer.
"Well, you're wrong," Abel went on. "Think about it. Why kill me?
If that's what this is about, Hollywood want me in a cell somewhere so they can sweat out every secret I've given away. When they'd bled me dry, they'd trade me, use me as a bargaining chip. But send you out here to shoot me? No. They're scared, Kane. Somebody wants to shut me up. Make sure I don't talk. More games. More lies." But Kane couldn't stop himself from playing.
Talk about what? Defiance. A flash of puzzlement ran through Kane's eyes. Defiance? That was a Treadstone mission. That's right.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.